Dance with the dead in my dreams. Listen to their hallowed screams. The Butcher of Plainfield, Ed Gein. So remember what I said about the Cult of Personality series? This is like that, but just replace cult with serial killer. Anyway, let's get to the good shit. Edward Theodore Gein was born on August 12, 1906 in La Crosse, Wisconsin, and from birth, the kid was doomed. The second son of George and Augusta Gein, Ed was raised by the twin demons of alcoholism and religious fanaticism. Yeah, this poor kid never had a chance. George Gein was a helpless alcoholic, and Augusta was an abusive religious nut job. From birth, Augusta Gein taught Ed and his brother Henry that their small town of La Crosse was a haven of sin and depravity, home of sodomites and harlots, or other biblical shit, I don't know. Augusta would also set aside time every single day for her to teach and read her sons the very graphic books of the Old Testament, particularly any sections that dealt with death and divine retribution. She also taught them that they were completely worthless, just like their father. And despite all of this, Ed came to idolize his insane fucking mother. In 1915, the family moved to Plainfield, Wisconsin, and all you gotta do is just look up some pictures and say, and you can see that the name is very fitting. Unless your name is Augusta Gein, then it should have been Sodomy Sinville McSinface the Sinful. Moving to a secluded farm on the edge of town, Augusta kept a tight hold of Henry and Ed, only ever allowing them out of her sight when they went to school and even forbid them from making friends while they were there. She also taught her two sons that the world was evil and that all women were lustful, vile harlots who corrupted and destroyed men. Tools of the devil himself. Look, even a broken clock is right twice a day. Not that any of this mattered, because once Ed graduated from high school, after a youth full of beatings and being bullied, he ran straight back into the arms of Augusta and never socialized with anybody else ever again. George Gein died of a booze-fueled heart attack on April 1st, 1940, and if Augusta had been a zealot before, then post-dead husband Augusta was an absolute raving fucking lunatic. All alone with her now 30-something-year-old sons, she doubled and tripled down on her teachings. All women were evil made flesh, the entire world was out to get them, and the only safe place was with Mama Dearest. Yeah, turns out God sometimes goes a little fucking overboard on April Fool's jokes. But the tragedy did not end there. Henry Gein had begun to reject his mother's teaching and her worldview, and had actually even started dating a divorced mother of two out in Plainfield. Augusta denounced him for abandoning the family because even Augusta Gein knew to avoid single mothers. I'm gonna get so much shit for that. Henry, like a good brother, had tried to convince Ed for some time to leave and come with him and leave their crazy abusive mother behind. According to some sources, Henry had been concerned about this for years because he was a good brother, and had actually confronted them about it on a few occasions. Unfortunately for Henry, however, Ed had long since made his choice. In 1944, a brush fire broke out on the Gein family farm. Henry and Ed went out to extinguish it, but the brothers got separated. That night, Ed Gein filed a report that his brother was missing. And once the police arrived, however, Ed was miraculously able to lead the police directly to Henry's face-down body. The grounds where Henry's body was laid was completely untouched by the fire, and he had several blows to the back of his head. Henry Gein's death was ruled as accidental by smoke inhalation, and Ed was never even questioned. And the now nearly 40-year-old Ed Gein was finally completely alone with his mother. And it's about to get really, really, really fucking weird. The news of Henry's death caused Augusta to have a stroke. She survived but was left disabled. For the next full year, the pair lived in almost complete isolation. They survived on the money Ed brought home from working various odd jobs, including as a babysitter. Yes, people actually let this guy watch their kids. Remember, 1944 and 45 was the years that was the year that World War II ended, and an entire nation was celebrating. But for Ed and Augusta, this went completely unnoticed. That's the level of creepy. That's the fucking level of creepy solitude that this relationship was at. The word toxic gets thrown around a lot, but if any relationship fits the mold, it's this one. Hell, that's actually probably not even a strong enough word for it. A second stroke carried Augusta away to her eternal reward on December 29th, 1945. Gein later said that this meant that he had lost his only friend and one true love, and that he was now completely alone in the world. Jesus fucking Christ. So what do you do if you're Ed Gein and the person you've idolized and been obsessed with for 40 years has finally kicked the bucket and is burning in hell? Well, simple. You seal off your mother's room as a shrine, leaving it exactly the way she left. Then you close off all the other rooms that she frequently used, leaving only two rooms unboarded, and then go completely fucking insane. This is where we get to the Ed Gein that everybody knows about. After his mother's death, Ed became obsessed with murder and horror and porn. One of these things is not like the others. He would feverishly read about human anatomy, and he read a lot about the Nazi and Japanese medical experiments from World War II, and began studying taxidermy, eventually teaching himself how to do it. In comes 1947. Beginning in 1947, Gein began exhuming and robbing the graves of women that were buried in the Plainfield Cemetery. Gein would dig up the bodies of large, middle-aged women, especially if they remembered his dear mother, and remove their hearts, heads, and genitals, and other organs before returning them to their graves during the night. Flash forward real quick. Gein later said in interviews and interrogations that with the police that he'd been in a daze when he visited the cemetery, and that he dreamed of digging up the graves and mutilating bodies, but he never thought he'd actually gone through with it. Yeah, we'll touch more on this later, but yeah, okay. The police records estimated that Gein had robbed the graves of more than 40 women, and by the 1950s, he wasn't even bothering to return the bodies, bringing them back to his crumbling farmhouse for his own use. We'll get into this later. During this whole time, Ed was still working various odd jobs as a part-time handyman, still taking random jobs just around the town. Ed would also allegedly give packages of venison to the people who'd hired him as a token of gratitude. And now dawns the 1950s. By this point, Ed wasn't technically a serial killer yet, despite the very probable murder of his brother 10 years prior. Note the word yet. That all changed December 8th, 1954. It was on this night that Ed Gein went to Pine Grove and shot Mary Hogan, a tavern owner who just happened to look an awful lot like Augusta, and brought her body back to. Once they arrived, Ed chopped up her body and used his taxidermy skills to turn her skin and body parts into furniture. Nothing quite like turning the local bartender into a matching set of chairs. Over the next 3 years, Gein fell further and further into his madness, quietly out of sight and mind for Plainfield. That is until November 16th, 1957. Bernice Warden was opening up her hardware store when Ed Gein stopped by and shot her. Since most of the town was out for hunting season, Gein was able to load her in the back of his truck and drive her body back to his farm with nobody being any the wiser. Well, this would be what finally got Gein. Bernice's son Frank was a deputy who stopped by the store to visit his mother the day before her death. During his visit, he'd noticed Gein lurking suspiciously around the store. At the time, he didn't think much of it, but following Bernice's death, he saw Gein's name as the last bill of sale and immediately suspected his involvement. Upon discovering this, Frank Warden called up the precinct and asked them to investigate Gein. Shortly after this, Ed Gein was arrested outside of a grocery store. That night, the cops raided the Gein farm. Now we get to the delicious gore that every sick fuck who studies serial killers is here for. Get your fucking lotion and tissues ready. Warning, graphic content to follow. If you're faint-hearted, one, why are you even here? And two, go ahead and skip to the timestamp I'm gonna put somewhere on screen. That being said, let's go ahead and dive in. The first place that the police searched was the barn. Bernice Warden's body was hanging upside down from the ceiling. It was completely gutted, mutilated, and beheaded. Allegedly, many of the officers thought it was the body of an animal because it was so badly hacked up. And the inside of the house was even worse. Inside the house, trash littered the place and bugs covered every surface. But all that paled in comparison to what else was found in the house. Let's do this. What was found is as follows. Bernice Warden's heart in a pot on the stove. Bernice Warden's head in a burlap sack. Human organs in the fridge. Mary Hogan's head in a paper bag. Bowls made from human skulls. 10 female heads with the tops sawn off. A box of 4 human noses. A shoebox of 9 vulvas underneath Gein's bed. 2 of which belong to girls under the age of 16. Skulls on Gein's bedpost. A pair of lips on a window drawstring. Lampshades made from human skin. Furniture covered with human skin. At least 9 masks made of human skin. A belt made of female nipples. How the fuck did you even do that? And a jacket made from a woman's torso, complete with a set of tits. Tights made out of leg skin and a corset made out of human skin. Fucking hell, that is gruesome. After the raid, Wisconsin Sheriff Art Shelley was allegedly so disgusted and disturbed by what he found that he savagely beat Ed Gein's head against a wall until he confessed to the murders. Shelley would be dead of a heart attack within a few months, and according to what his friend said, it was very likely due to stress from PTSD caused by what he found in Ed Gein's house. Well, with Gein now in custody, he said that he had no idea how many people he'd killed. And to this day, nobody really knows. He'd only ever confessed to 2, and that's widely considered to be what his number was. And the state wasn't really willing to spend a whole lot of money to investigate this. He's been linked to several missing persons reports, but then again, it's also equally likely that he was just a convenient scapegoat for any missing persons that they had. And immediately following his arrest, Ed became a celebrity. As a result of the massive wave of press, his story gripped the U.S. with the details of his house of horrors. Insert other hyperbolic descriptions here. I don't think I was supposed to read that part. During his interrogations, Ed Gein claimed that ever since Augusta's death, he'd wanted to be a woman. Most likely, he'd wanted to be one woman in particular, his mother. When I assume this is why he'd made his woman's suit and would dress in women's skin at night, including wearing masks made out of women's faces and said jacket that I mentioned earlier with tits. He also claimed that when he went to the cemeteries in a trance, he'd come to 30 times and left empty-handed. Although the 40-plus empty graves either disproves that or just means he went way more times than they originally thought he had. And despite some rumors, Gein does claim that he had never had sex with any of the bodies since they smelled too bad. But apparently they didn't smell enough to not make furniture out of them. On November 21st, 1957, Ed Gein stood trial, pleading not guilty by reason of insanity. In January 1958, he was found mentally unfit to stand trial and sent to the Central State Hospital for the Criminally Insane. Later that year, his farmhouse burned down, very likely by arson. And when Gein found out about it, he simply shrugged and said, just as well. After 10 years in the hospital, Gein was finally declared mentally capable of standing trial, and the week-long trial began on November 14th, 1968. Ed Gein was found guilty of first-degree murder. However, since he was legally insane at the time of the murder, Gein was sent back to the hospital where he remained until his death from cancer on July 26th, 1984. What has endured the most from Ed Gein's story was his influence on pop culture. As many people know, Gein was the influence for Norman Bates in Psycho, Leatherface in the Texas Chainsaw Massacre, Buffalo Bill in Silence of the Lambs, not to mention plenty of other songs like Slayer's Dead Skin Mask, which I played at the beginning of this video. That's all I got for you guys today. Take it easy, keep it sleazy. Thank you, fuck you, bye.
Mr. Misanthropic, go fuck yourself. Dance with the devil.